President, please be seated.
Le président. Veuillez vous asseoir.
The court is now back in session.
Reprise des débats.
Per email sent to the parties by the senior legal officer on the 25th, 28th, and 30 September 2015, that this afternoon the trial chamber will hear observations and submissions by parties on three issues. The first is the request by the defense team for Nguyen Chi for the chamber to hear an additional witness in relation to the Piantmo-Lem work site that is pursuant to Rule 87.4 of the internal rules. I refer to document E368. And the second issue for discussion this afternoon is the observations
le deuxième point dont
from all parties in relation to the letter by the International Co-Investigating Judge regarding the proceedings to hear testimony of an expert, that is to TCE 95, before the trial chamber, that is document E367/1. And the third item is the disclosure of 11 documents from case 04 to case 02/02 by the International Co-Investigating International Co-Prosecutor in relation to the treatment of JAM, that is document E319/33. Additionally, we'll hear the submission by Kirsten Porn defense team regarding a certain matter. Let me now move on to the first item for our discussion this afternoon.
Point de discussion, donc.
And the chamber would like to ask the parties whether they wish to make their observation regarding the request by the defense team for Nguyen Chi. And in order to clarify the matter, the chamber would like to hand the floor to the defense team for Nguyen Chi to provide a brief summary of your request to hear an additional witness in relation to the Trapiantmo-Dem work site. You can proceed, counsel.
Maître, vous avez la parole.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
I don't think I have actually that much to add to our request. I think it is argued why this particular witness is necessary to hear in relation to Trapiantmo-Dem. I think he can potentially provide very interesting evidence as to structures, etc., at the dam, but of course also in relation to possible events in the Northwest Zone in more general terms. You know that we have confronted certain witnesses already with his testimony.
Déjà présenté
so I think
des positions à des témoins
this particular witness is an important witness and should come to the courtroom to testify. So I think all our arguments are in here, so
tous
I have nothing really
ont été
to add
dans les
specifically. Thank
je n'ai rien à ajouter à ce moment.
Thank you, counsel, and the chamber would like to give the floor to the co-prosecutors
au bureau des co-procureurs.
To make your observation or response to the request by the defense team for Nguyen Chi on this said topic. You may proceed.
Thank you, Mr. President. I think I can be very brief. The prosecution does not oppose the defense request to hear this additional witness. Given the fact that his WRI and his DC CAM statement are both already before the chamber, and given the fact that they've been used with a number of witnesses, we think it's a reasonable request. We think that perhaps the defense's primary point is the witness's evidence regarding what they would characterize as a planned rebellion. In our submission, the written evidence that's now before the chamber is ambiguous and incomplete in that regard, and for that reason, we submit that it would be reasonable to call the additional witness. I would just add that we don't agree with the defense's characterization of his evidence on the conditions at the dam as being exculpatory. We would submit that the excerpts of his evidence they've selected are very narrow and don't accurately portray the whole of his evidence, and that his evidence regarding the conditions will ultimately be inculpatory. But I also believe that's a conversation that we can have at another time. So, in short, Your Honor, we don't oppose the defense's motion.
Nous ne nous opposons pas à la requête. Le président.
Thank you. And the lead co-lawyers for civil parties, you wish to make an observation?
Ont-ils des observations?
Mr. President, the lead co-lawyers do not have any observations or oppose this request. Thank you.
Merci.
President.
Le président.
And I believe the defense team for Kyiv Sampon does not have any objection to the request. If you have any, please take the floor.
Non, Monsieur le Président.
No, Mr. President.
Nous en rapportons la sagesse de la Chambre.
We will rely on the Chamber's wisdom.
Le President, thank you. Thank
Merci.
You. And let me move to the second issue. That is in relation to the content of the letter by the International Co-Investigating Judge.
Le contenu de la lettre du co-juge d'instruction.
Before we decide whether or how the hearing of the testimony of the expert to TCE 95 is to be organized, the Chamber wishes to hear opinions from the concerned parties.
La Chambre souhaite entendre les observations
First,
des parties
the Chamber
à ce
would
sujet.
Like to hand the floor to the co-prosecutors. You may proceed.
Vous avez la parole.
Thank you, Your Honors. Good afternoon to everyone.
Merci,
Your Honor, the co-prosecutors have read the letter from the international co-investigating judge. We believe his request to have a legal officer present is reasonable. We understand that investigations are confidential, not by his discretionary decision, but by law at the ECCC. I would say, though, that I don't anticipate that there should be a great problem with any disclosures of confidential information. I do not, the prosecution does not plan to ask the expert about what people said to OCIJ. Those records of interview are on the case file already, the relevant ones, and they speak for themselves. We will be asking the expert questions regarding the CHAM and what happened to them based on his work. He has written two books. He clearly has made many, many, many interviews outside of his work for the OCIJ. But I do think it's reasonable, the concern of the international co-investigating judge, and because his concerns are reasonable, it would be advantageous, I believe, but up to your honors, to have a legal officer from that chamber present to bring to your honors' attention any concerns they have about disclosing confidential information.
L'éventualité ou pour satisfaire aux préoccupations de la divulgation
d'informations confidentielles. And the lead co-lawyers for civil parties, you wish to make any observation to give your opinion on the content of the letter of the international co-investigating judge?
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Pas d'observation particulière à la lettre
to make with regard to that letter,
que nous avons lue,
which we have read.
Nous nous en référons
so we will
à la sagesse de la Chambre sur ce point. Nous nous adapterons.
Chamber's wisdom regarding that issue.
Thank you.
Le président.
And the
Merci.
Defense team for Nguyen-Chi, do you wish to make an observation regarding the content of that letter?
Sujet de cette lettre.
that is in relation to the hearing of the testimony of two TCE 95 in the very near future, that is in relation to this case.
Dans le cadre de ce dossier.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
We're not convinced yet that it is quite as simple as the prosecution is describing. Let me first say, of course, there are confidentiality issues in case 4. There's no dispute or discussion, I think, there. However, Mr. Osman is primarily here to come to testify as an expert. That is a personal obligation of him to the court. It's up to him, first of all, to decide whether he, when answering any questions, is violating certain procedural rules or certain confidentiality issues in the investigation. So I think all parties should be able to ask all the questions they would like to ask. It is then up to Mr. Osman to decide whether answering any such question would bring him into problems. And then it's up to you to decide whether he, in a particular instance, can indeed decline to answer. So it is there that potential problems might arise, obviously not in the questions that we are asking. Let me give you an example. Obviously, in our case, in this trial, we're talking about events at Wat Otakun, Wat Otakun, the pagoda. We all know that this particular pagoda is part of the investigation of case 4.
Fait l'objet d'enquête dans le cadre de l'instruction 4.
If I would ask him in general terms about what he knows of, for instance, the command structure at Wat Otakun, he would potentially get into problems because this very same topic is being investigated right now. In theory, it might not seem problematic, but in practice, we could enter quickly a situation where there's all kinds of debates coming as to whether his answers are bound by are ruled by the confidentiality restrictions or not. So, the problem is that we are both dealing with the same investigations, or at least partially, that are being done in case 4. I think that should be resolved per question,
but I'm not quite sure
how, in this very simple example, things would go, because strictly speaking, he could answer, I cannot say anything about that, because technically he would be right, because that is part of case 4. But if it's such a broad formulation, then it will possibly end up in him not giving any answers, for instance, about what happened in Sector 41, or more particularly in Wat Otakun. In respect of the question whether someone should be sitting next to him, that is, I think, also not without problems. I think there is some comparable case law at the ICTY,
au TPY, il y a
in which, in the appeal proceedings, I think it was in the Milosevic case,
where
two government officials were present in the courtroom while a witness was while a witness was answering questions. The appeals chamber ruled that although there was no provision to do this, the trial chamber at that time was allowed to have government officials in the courtroom.
But I don't think
these government officials were allowed to intervene
with
the particular witness. They couldn't coach him, or they couldn't say that one question or the other question could be answered yes or no. Having said that, the question then arises whether Ms. Ewing, who is, I understand, a legal officer, is the one who should be entitled to be present and possibly to assist the expert. In my own jurisdiction, that would be typically, a lawyer representing the witness who could advise the witness whether certain questions should be answered yes or no. I don't think, or maybe that is the case, but I'd be happy to hear that, whether Mrs. Ewing is in fact admitted to the Cambodian bar and allowed to advise the expert. I think that is something that we should find out, and the expert is sitting here. It is personal title, and therefore, I think if assisted by someone in the courtroom, it should be a lawyer allowed to practice in the courts of Cambodia. So, I think in theory it might not be problematic, but in practice it could be problematic. So I think we should have a debate on how exactly we should proceed with the expert, especially when it comes to issues in relation to Sector 41 or Wat Ootrakoon. Thank you.
Merci.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Pour la défense de Kyo Sampan,
as far as we are concerned in the Kyo Sampan defense,
en fait, il y a deux questions qui se posent.
Two issues.
Nous comprenons bien
so we understand
le caractère confidentiel des instructions en cours,
nature of the investigation in the process,
et en même temps,
and at the same time,
si l'expert de TCE 95 a été appelé par la Chambre en tant qu'expert, c'est qu'on estime qu'il a des informations utiles pour des faits qui concernent les faits objets des débats devant la Chambre et qui, pour M. Kyo Sampan en tant qu'accusé, doivent pouvoir être débattus de façon publique.
These facts should be debated
huis clos n'étant que quelque chose de particulièrement
exceptionnel.
Sur les interviews, les entretiens de cet expert avec un certain nombre de témoins qui ont déposé devant cette chambre, je pense qu'il n'y a pas de difficulté puisqu'ils font effectivement partie du dossier.
All these interviews are part of the case file.
Les réponses à d'autres questions comme celle que vient d'évoquer mon confrère de façon plus générale, l'expert, s'il est expert et si on considère comme ayant un niveau d'expert, doit pouvoir seul, sans l'assistance de qui que ce soit, pouvoir déterminer ce qu'il est en mesure de dire ou de ne pas dire. Nous ne faisons pas référence à un témoin lambda ce qui la Chambre a estimé nécessaire de l'appeler en tant qu'expert. Et je rappelle à ce sujet que la défense de Quesantan, anticipant ces problèmes, ne souhaitait pas qu'il comparaisse comme expert, mais enfin, la décision de la Chambre a été prise dans ces conditions. Il faut le traiter comme n'importe quel expert et faire en sorte qu'il puisse, de façon indépendante, répondre sans qu'on n'ait besoin de lui tenir la main, répondre aux questions en faisant bien évidemment application de ses obligations de confidentialité s'il en a. Je pense que s'il si a effectivement suivi l'expert, il n'a pas besoin que quelqu'un l'assiste. Que une personne du bureau des coaches d'instruction soit dans la salle pour pouvoir suivre plus pleinement les débats, il n'y a pas de souci, mais que cette personne puisse intervenir et suggérer à l'expert de répondre dans tel ou tel sens ne me semble pas adéquate dans un débat judiciaire. Donc ça, c'est la position de la défense de Quesantan. S'il vient en tant qu'expert, s'il témoigne en tant qu'expert en répondant au mieux de ses possibilités des informations qu'il a, dans le respect, évidemment, on ne demande pas de violer ses obligations professionnelles dans le respect de ses obligations professionnelles. Voilà sur la question de la manière dont nous envisageons l'audience, étant précisé qu'en tout état de cause, nous, ce qui nous intéresse, c'est ce qui figure au dossier 02-2, ce qui concerne les faits pour lesquels Monsieur Quesantan a été renvoyé devant cette chambre et en espérant avec un minimum d'entrée d'éléments de preuve qui sont en cours d'investigation et qui ne sont a priori pas l'objet de la présence de Monsieur Quesantan devant cette chambre puisqu'il a été renvoyé sur non pas des éléments de 004 ni de 003 mais des éléments dans le dossier pour lequel il a été parti à l'instruction. Donc ça c'est les observations que nous avons à faire sur ce point. Nous avons d'autres observations à faire sur l'expert. Je ne sais pas si Monsieur le Président vous souhaitez que je les fasse maintenant de façon à ce que les parties puissent répondre sur le tout ou si vous souhaitez d'abord poser des questions éventuellement cet aspect.
Regarding what we have just said.
President, let me solve this issue one at a time.
Just
want to make one comment. I don't expect the parties here to answer this question, but for me, frankly, it's not completely clear. If one reads the request, point A, it would appear that the investigating judge says he cannot be asked any questions gathered during O4 investigation under any circumstances. So, no matter whether it's closed or open session, completely closed. While if one reads the paragraph above, it appears to indicate that it might be possible to ask him these questions in closed session because it says if this will take place in open court, he will not be at liberty to disclose.
So
I think we might have to clarify actually what that means. Does he want to preclude any information under any circumstances that he considers confidential or would he agree to such information being given in closed court?
I believe it's my understanding of the letter that the defense seems to be misconstruing what Judge Bolander is asking the legal officer to do. It is not to represent Yassar Osman, the witness. It is to represent his office in making sure that confidential information from that investigation is not disclosed. Counsel's indicated that some complex issues could arise from his questioning about what can and cannot be disclosed. I don't believe Mr. the witness is a lawyer himself.
And
the judge in charge of the investigation has asked to have a lawyer from his office represent his office, not the witness. Clearly, it would be improper for any legal officer representing the judge to tell the witness how to answer a question. That would be wrong, not to give them information about how to answer, but she should be allowed to advise the court, Your Honors, about what types of questions would lead to violations of the confidentiality required in those investigations, or to confer, I believe, with the witness to determine if his answer would reveal confidential information, and then instruct him whether, or tell Your Honors whether or not he is permitted to give that answer. But again, he's not representing, or the legal officer would not be representing the witness, they're representing the office of the co-investigating judges.
If I may respond quickly, Mr. President. In this courtroom in case 002, the international co-investigating judge has no status. He is no party. He is someone, of course, that we're dealing with because of the statements that he's disclosing to us. But as such, his office has no standing in this courtroom. Following from that, any legal officer from his office has no status in this courtroom. Only lawyers, like for instance lawyers advising witnesses not to answer questions if that could incriminate themselves, the witnesses, these are parties or functionaries who actually have proper standing in this court. A legal officer representing an organ which doesn't have any standing in this court, I don't think, is a proper way of proceeding. If I read the letter from the international co-investigating judge, it says, should any questions arise regarding the proper scope of his testimony, this will permit him, the expert, to consult her, the legal officer, in the presence of the trial chamber and the parties.
So,
not being his lawyer, would cause a very unusual situation, I think. A representative or the office itself have no proper standing in case 002. So that's why I think we should be very precise in this respect. And if you were to decide that a legal officer has a functioning or can function in this court, we should be very clear as to what her position is. So I do think it is problematic.
Nous pensons que ça pose problème.
Juste une précision pour indiquer que la défense de Que Sampan, outre les observations que j'ai évoquées, rappelle que la décision de la Chambre E319-7 sur la manière d'utiliser des documents venant d'une instruction en cours serait également appliqué par les parties. Je ne sais pas si je peux rentrer dans le détail en audience publique de la manière dont nous devons procéder, mais enfin, il y avait déjà une procédure mise en place par la Chambre pour les documents relatifs à des instructions en cours. Donc, les mêmes mesures, je suppose, seraient également applicables dans le cadre des questions posées à l'expert.
To the questions that will be put to the expert.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Juste une courte observation.
Thank you, Mr. President. I would like to make a brief
remark.
Le Président.
The President, please hold on. Let's finish on the defense team. Council Kungsamon,
you may proceed.
Kungsamon. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. President. I would like to draw the Chamber's attention and the party's attention to the request made by the international co-investigating judge.
I
understand the endeavor of the investigating judge to maintain confidentiality of the other future cases other than case 002, slash 02. I would like to draw the attention of the Chamber to consider the publicity of the proceedings of this court in balance of the right of my client as well as the other accused in case 002/02. Because we have the proceeding, the protective measures on the documents in case 003 and 004 and how to proceed to maintain confidentiality of the cases. So if there is any restriction in any manner when such restrictions or that material restriction may affect the interest of my client,
cela pourrait avoir une incidence sur les droits et les intérêts de mon client.
It does not oblige us to follow the respect of confidentialities that may run in contradiction to the interests of my client, because we are here to represent the interests of our client. So if there is any dispute which the investigating judges has warned that we not raise any questions that might affect the interest of my client, that will hinder the ability of the defense to represent the interest of our client. There is no law to restrict the accused to abandon their
their legal interest in order to safeguard the confidentiality of something else.
The President, the international legal lawyer for the civil party, you may proceed.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr.
La règle qui me paraît importante ici, c'est la règle 56 du règlement intérieur qui dit que l'instruction est secrète, mais que toute personne y participant est tenue à la confidentialité. Donc, il s'agit d'une obligation personnelle qui incombe à chaque personne participant à l'instruction de ne pas révéler des obligations, des informations qui sont confidentielles. Donc, je suis pour le coup d'accord avec nos confrères de la défense pour dire qu'il appartient à Issa Osman de savoir quelles sont les informations qui rentrent dans le champ de son obligation de confidentialité et celles qu'il ne peut pas révéler. Donc, pour moi, deux solutions s'offrent à la Chambre. Soit Issa Osman est assisté d'un conseil qui peut le conseiller sur l'étendue de son obligation de confidentialité au regard de son contrat avec OCIJ, soit vous décidez d'avoir le legal officer qui est proposé par les co-juges d'instruction qui viendrait, quant à elle, représenter les intérêts du bureau des co-juges d'instruction. Mais quant à M. Issa Osman, il est tenu par une obligation de confidentialité. Cette obligation lui est personnelle et c'est à lui qui incombe de définir les paramètres de son obligation de confidentialité.
Your Honor, I just wanted to point out that what counsel said earlier is correct. There is some precedent of lawyers for outside organizations representing a witness, not the witness, excuse me, but representing, in this case, governments. And counsel mentioned the Milosevic case. In these other tribunals, they have rules regarding national interests, that information that can compromise national interests can be provided to the court under certain circumstances and kept confidential. So in the Milosevic case, Wesley Clark
the general from the United States, Ambassador Orkin, U.S. Ambassador, testified with U.S. government representatives present to argue about the applicability of that rule, Rule 70, to limit his testimony. Also, in the more recent case in Stanisic, case, the UK ambassador, I believe his name was Roberts, testified, and representatives of the government of the United Kingdom did not represent him, they represented his government in saying what information would be confidential that he could not be asked about or could not disclose. So it's exactly the same situation in this case. To ask the witness, a non-lawyer, to make those determinations, I think would be very unfair to him and to the office of co-investigating judges. Especially since we've heard from defense counsel just now that they anticipate that they may ask about confidential information and disclose it because it's in the interest of their client.
The President, Judge Jean-Marc Lavergne, please, you may proceed.
Oui, ceci est une simple réaction à ce que je viens d'entendre de la part de la co-avocate principale pour les parties civiles, disant qu'il y a deux options, soit il est assisté d'un avocat, soit il y a la présence de quelqu'un représentant le bureau des co-juges d'instruction. Je
ne
vois pas tellement quel serait l'intérêt d'avoir un avocat présent dans la salle pour conseiller M. Issa Osman, dans la mesure où cet avocat n'est pas un avocat d'une partie impliqué dans l'instruction, donc il ne peut pas avoir accès au dossier de l'instruction. Donc je ne vois pas très bien comment il pourrait discuter des problèmes de confidentialité susceptibles de se poser. Moi, j'ai mal compris quelque chose, peut-être Maître Guiraud, clarifier cette proposition, mais je ne la saisis pas très bien.
What she was proposing because I don't quite understand.
Je vous écoute, monsieur le juge, et je me rends compte effectivement que ce n'est peut-être pas une bonne solution. Mais je voulais simplement rappeler à la Chambre que c'est une obligation de confidentialité qui est personnelle et que, en premier lieu et avant tout, il appartiendra à l'expert de déterminer si les informations et les questions qui lui sont posées lui amènerait à partager avec nous des informations qu'il considère comme confidentielles.
Information that he considers confidential.
One brief point, if you allow me, Mr. President, I would like to make.
Both
the civil party lawyer and Judge Lavergne are speaking of the office of the co-investigating judges. I don't think that is properly formulated. It's a request of only the international co-investigating judge. And you might think, well, does that matter? Well, possibly it might matter, especially in the light of a very recent decision. A decision that was released on last Friday in the case of Mias Mout's urgent request for a stay of execution of his arrest warrant.
La requête de Mias Mout pour
there's a very interesting
remettre à plus tard
paragraph
son
in
il y a un paragraphe
the opinion
très intéressant
of the three national judges.
Dans l'opinion des trois juges nationaux,
had asked
Mias Mout a demandé
to asked for a stay of the execution of the arrest warrant,
l'exécution du mandat
and
d'arrêt soit
had asked that to the pretrial chamber, and the pretrial chamber national judges
reporté à ce qu'il y a un sursis,
said the following thing, and that's very interesting.
Les juges nationaux disent la chose
the arrest warrant
le mandat
is a coercive measure,
est une mesure coercitive
to be enforced by judicial
qui
police
doit être,
to bring
me
as moot before the international co-investigating judge alone, but not before both co-investigating judges. This measure in Cambodian society is regarded as humiliating and affecting Mias Mout's honor, dignity,
à la dignité, and rights à l'honneur substantially and irremediably.
The President, can you explain the court what the ground for your intervention here, because we are now discussing on the issue of the legal officer at the Office of International Co-Investigating Judge and the documents that you are presenting to us. Can you please explain us first the reason and its annexes? How is it related to the methodology, particularly the that we did not hear the TCE 95, and now that we require that there is the presence of the legal officer of the international co-investigating judge to assist in reminding or clarifying whether or not that should respond or not, and whether or not that relates to the confidentiality of the case.
I was getting to my point, Mr. President.
It seems that
the pretrial judges, the national pretrial judges, are making a distinction if a measure, coercive measure, or anything is coming from only the international co-investigating judges, rather than from both.
Now,
the reason I was standing up is that we are talking about a letter or request from only the international co-investigating judges. And if that is the case, it seems that national judges should react differently, possibly, to such requests. So I'm just making the observation that we're speaking about the Office of the Co-Investigating Judges. That's not accurate. We're speaking about a request only of the International Co-Investigating Judge. And a similar request from an International Co-Investigating Judge was met by the national judges in case 4 as something affecting the accused's right substantially and irremediably. So I think we should also maybe hear from the national co-prosecutor what the position is in relation to this request in respect of the expert only coming from the Office of the International Co-Investigating Judge.
Il s'agirait de préciser qu'il s'agit seulement du bureau du juge d'instruction international.
The President, the President. National Prosecutor, do you have any observation on this issue? Prosecutor. Mr. President, on this point, the National Prosecutor has no comment. The President. Mr. Victor Coppe, are you saying that this request is not valid and it should not be the subject of the discussion, and that this issue is acceptable? It's not on the issue of forms, but it is the substance that we discuss. Is that your position, that if it is admitted, it is not right procedurally, or what?
Nous ne respecterions pas la procédure en...
Well,
de la
it is our position when it comes to the request to summon three witnesses.
We, last week, we filed our response, nous avons déposé
and we
notre
argued
la semaine dernière.
That
nous avons
the request from the international co-prosecutor was null and void and could not be entertained by the trial judge. So it is our position in relation to that particular request. It will be our position in relation to the pending requests for disclosure
s'agissant de la requête en souffrance sur les communications et for, le fait d'admettre en preuve un certain nombre d'autres éléments.
I'm not entirely sure yet because the decision is a bit ambiguous.
La décision quant à elle est un peu ambiguë.
But I think we can all agree that there is a problem.
Mais nous sommes tous d'accord, legal problem, je crois, pour dire qu'ici il y a un problème.
International co-investigating judge asking this and his national counterpart is completely silent.
So I think it is a problem. Yes. Tandis que son confrère national se tait. Je pense que là on a un vrai problème.
I would just point out that the national co-investigating judge has consistently stressed the confidentiality of the investigation.
A insisté sur le caractère confidentiel, et ce de façon continue, de l'instruction.
Let us move to the other subject.
Passons à présent au sujet suivant.
Topic 3 for the chamber to arrange the scheduling order, particularly the scheduling for the hearing of the expert
TCE 95 in the future.
The chamber wishes to ask the international prosecutor whether or not you want to put more documents in addition to the recently put document, such as document E, /33 or not, and if so, what are the documents that you are likely to submit in relation to the treatment to the target group?
Thank you. Your Honours, from our review today, the status is that we have completed the review of all the written records of interview, in better in English, on the case 4 case file, and all of them that are related to the CHAM have been disclosed. There still are 27 records of interview that are in Khmer only that we are in the process of having reviewed with the limited staff that we have that can review those in Khmer. So I don't know whether or not they will be the subject of a disclosure motion or not. There also are 3 requests currently pending before the Office of the Co-Investigating Judges for disclosure of a few civil party applications, and we're awaiting, I would expect decisions soon, but we're awaiting those. But those are only civil party applications, not records of interview. And I would stress that we've taken to heart what Your Honor said about the prosecution being very limiting, using our discretion to be only request only the most critical civil party applications for admission under 87.4. But these are being reviewed also for whether or not, of course, there's any exculpatory information. There still are, from my understanding today, about 400 applications, victim applications, civil party applications that have not yet been reviewed, and those we would also review under the same criteria. Now, this is unless the defense is saying, and Your Honors wish us not to review those. If everyone doesn't want us to review those, I'm happy not to do that. It's a lot of work for us. But the current plan is to fulfill our obligations to the defense in the chamber and to continue to review those last 400 applications. We've reviewed about 1,300 applications already.
Pour l'instant, nous allons Nous en avons déjà examiné 1300.
Can I just ask a supplementary question? I believe you mentioned 27 are currently under consideration. Is that correct?
There are 27 that are not in English. Yeah. They're in Khmer, and they're in the process of, which is much slower, of having those reviewed.
So can you give me any indication as to if any of those will be disclosed, when this will be?
Ces documents, ou
and obviously they need to be translated because only in Khmer.
So, I mean, it would take some time. I don't know the answer to that, really. I'd be just guessing.
L'accusation, je ne le sais pas. Je ne pourrais que vous donner une idée.
President Councilor Victor Copé, you may proceed.
President, Maître Copé, vous avez la parole.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Monsieur le Président.
One remark.
Une remarque.
The documents that were disclosed yesterday contains a WRI of a witness considered to be very important, maybe the most important one. This witness was only interviewed a few weeks ago, a month ago. This means that the investigation is ongoing as we speak. This means that it will not stop, obviously, with those 27 or the 7 from yesterday, but it will continue. And I think that is the crux of the problem. It will go on, even now as we speak.
L'instruction va continuer.
And just for the record, of course, that is correct. The investigation goes on, so we continue to have them come in, these records of interview. I would say that we were behind, and we pretty much caught up to the backlog. So now we're dealing only with them as they come in, so it'll be a much faster turnaround.
À ce stade, Monsieur le Président,
at this stage, Mr. President,
j'interviens évidemment pour dire que nous attendons du côté de la défense de Queulles-Sampan avec impatience la réponse à notre requête. Peut-être qu'il y aura des limitations qui seraient utiles à l'accélération de ce procès, puisqu'encore une fois, je note que souvent, dans la presse, c'est souvent repris d'ailleurs, qu'on accorde des délais à la défense pour examiner de nouveaux documents. C'est important de souligner que ce n'est pas des délais qui sont demandés inutilement, mais qui sont demandés uniquement par la communication de nouveaux documents. Donc, c'est important de le dire. En ce qui concerne les deux récentes communications par les coprocureurs, celle d'aujourd'hui ou d'hier, je ne sais plus, nous n'avons toujours pas accès. Enfin, en tout cas, il y a quelques minutes, nous n'avions pas accès à ces nouveaux documents. Donc, il y a une requête qui a été déposée en communication de documents, mais nous n'avons pas encore accès à ces documents-là. Donc, il y a aussi ces questions de délai de mise à disposition qui s'ajoutent aux problèmes déjà évoqués. Donc, vraiment, nous attendons vivement votre décision pour voir si ça ne peut pas limiter le flux de ces informations. Encore une fois, l'instruction 004 et l'instruction 003 ne sont pas des instructions dans lesquelles M. Queulles-Sampan est parti.
Hand over the floor to the defense team for Queulles-Sampan to
l'équipe de défense de Queulles-Sampan
present the request
that
they made actually through email to the trial chamber.
Envoyé
so you may now
à la chambre. Vous avez à présent la parole
enlighten the chamber briefly and
rapidement
orally
exposer
on this request.
Oralement cela à la chambre.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Je vais commencer d'abord par le point qui concerne l'expert dont nous avons évoqué la comparution tout à l'heure. Je pense que ma première demande est extrêmement logique. Dans le cadre de votre premier calendrier, vous aviez programmé cet expert en fin de segment après l'audition de toutes les personnes ayant trait au segment du traitement des CHAM pour des raisons diverses et variées qui ne sont évidemment pas du fait de la Chambre, mais qui sont des problèmes de programmation. Un certain nombre de témoins qui devaient comparaître n'ont pas pu comparaître aux périodes anticipées. Je crois comprendre que ces témoins vont être appelés à une date ultérieure. Donc ma première demande est évidemment de faire en sorte que l'expert puisse toujours témoigner après la comparution de ces témoins-là, puisque un certain nombre de ces témoins ont été entendus par lui, et que dans le cadre de notre interrogatoire, nous avons l'intention de revenir sur ces entretiens, évidemment ce qui aura été dit à la barre par ces témoins. Et qu'en conséquence, il est plus logique que cet expert comparaisse après la comparution de tous les témoins sur le segment. Ça, c'est un premier point. Le deuxième point, qui est en lien avec le premier, à savoir que nous avons, au fil des audiences, constaté qu'il y a un certain nombre de documents que nous aimerions pouvoir soumettre à l'expert, des parties que nous voudrions pouvoir lui faire commenter, et que compte tenu de ce qui se passe à l'audience, lorsqu'on doit donner des URL, lorsqu'on doit donner lecture de certaines parties, que ça prend du temps. Nous anticipons du côté de la défense de Kyo-Sampan que les deux jours qui avaient été initialement prévus par la Chambre qui correspondraient pour l'équipe de Kyo-Sampan à une demi-journée d'interrogatoire, c'est-à-dire 2h20 à peu près, serait certainement trop courte pour permettre la revue dans un délai raisonnable des différents documents et différentes déclarations et différents points que nous aimerions aborder avec l'expert. Et donc, nous souhaitons pour que ça ne soit pas comme souvent la course en dernière minute et de demander des minutes supplémentaires. Nous voudrions demander à la Chambre d'envisager au moins une session supplémentaire de plus par partie. Je ne sais pas, je parle pour la défense de Kyo-Sampan. Je ne sais pas si c'est la même chose pour les autres parties, mais en tout état de cause, uniquement pour le caractère pratique de l'organisation de l'interrogatoire, la demi-journée pour l'équipe de Kyo-Sampan paraît un peu courte si on veut un interrogatoire qui soit quand même audible et compréhensible. Voilà, sur ce thème précis, ce que la défense de Kyo-Sampan avait à dire. Si vous souhaitez d'abord donner la parole aux autres parties, si vous avez des questions particulières sur ce point avant que j'aborde l'autre requête, l'autre point que j'ai évoqué dans mon email.
The President, you may proceed to your second request.
Le Président, vous pouvez en passer à votre deuxième requête.
La deuxième requête est peut-être prématurée, mais est en réponse à la question que je n'avais pas bien comprise d'ailleurs lorsqu'elle avait été posée par Madame le juge Fence il y a quelques jours en audience, à savoir de combien de temps la défense aurait besoin pour préparer les audiences d'appel, puisque c'était, si je comprends bien, une préoccupation de la Chambre dans le cadre de la détermination de son calendrier. Nous n'avons pas encore d'ordonnance fixant les audiences devant la Cour suprême. Nous anticipons, selon les échanges officieux, que des audiences de plaidoirie devraient intervenir, c'est sûr, avant la fin de l'année, quelque part mi-novembre, peut-être entre mi-novembre, enfin il y a une fourchette entre mi-novembre, fin novembre et peut-être éventuellement début décembre, je ne sais pas, puisqu'il y a aussi une semaine avec des jours fériés. Donc nous ne savons pas exactement combien, quand ces audiences auront lieu, mais nous avons une fourchette, en tout cas d'une dizaine de jours, et nous avons calculé en fonction du travail qui a effectué que nous aurions besoin au niveau des avocats de la défense qui sont ceux qui vont plaider. Nous aurions besoin de 5 semaines sans audience pour préparer ces audiences de plaidoirie qui, comme vous le savez peut-être, seront non seulement le moment d'exposer nos point d'appel, hein, mais, mais également le seul moment où nous pourrons répliquer à la réponse des autres parties, puisqu'il n'y a pas de réplique écrite qui a été prévue par la Cour suprême. Donc il y a un travail important qui sera à faire sur, sur ce point. Par ailleurs, il y a aussi une possibilité, il y a eu des... témoins nouveaux qui ont été entendus et ces éléments nouveaux seront également débattus oralement. Et il y a une possibilité, nous n'en savons pas encore, d'éventuellement, dans le cadre de cette programmation de plaidoirie devant la Cour suprême, une peut-être possibilité d'audition d'autres témoins. Donc ça aussi, c'est un élément à prendre en préparation. Donc nous avons calculé, puisque nous ne pouvons pas être à la fois au four et au moulin, c'est-à-dire à la fois être à l'audience devant cette chambre et à la fois en train de préparer ces importantes plaidoiries. Quand je dis importantes plaidoiries, vous l'aurez compris, nous savons que c'est la dernière ligne droite avant une décision qui aura un impact sur le procès 02-2. Et c'est important, je pense, pour l'ensemble des parties, mais particulièrement pour la défense. Donc, voilà les éléments que je peux vous donner à ce stade. Je ne sais pas du tout, encore une fois, quelle sera la, la date retenue par la Cour suprême, mais en termes de durée de travail sur ce que nous avons à faire, 5 semaines à temps plein pour les co-avocats sont nécessaires.
Le président.
I have one question for the council, for Kyu Sampon. I refer to your first request as for the times we want to allocate to put the question to the CA 95. According to you, it's rather short. So, to you, what or how much time do you think is appropriate for you to put the question to this expert? Because generally, if you ask for the extension of time, other parties might ask for the extension as well.
Oui, effectivement, là pour le coup, je ne demandais pas, et c'est pour ça que je fais la demande en amont. C'était que pour éventuellement toutes les parties puissent en bénéficier. Pour moi, un minimum de 3 sessions serait nécessaire pour l'interrogatoire de l'expert. Donc, au lieu d'avoir une demi-journée, d'avoir 3 sessions. Voilà, d'avoir, en avoir 2, d'en avoir
3.
Thank you. How about the defense team for Nguyen Chia? Do you have any issues regarding this extension of time for putting question? The 5 weeks to prepare the submission.
Une pause de 5 semaines pour préparer.
Closing submission in relation to the appeal and the decision of the Supreme Court Chamber.
Votre appel.
Thank you, Mr. President. We understood the request to be that as soon as there is an official scheduling order, that we should give our views as to how long preparation time should be. It's still unclear whether it is indeed between 10 and 20 November or maybe even the first 2 weeks of December. I think that is now maybe debated at the Supreme Court chamber. Having said that, I do not think the request of the Kyu Sampon team to ask for 5 weeks is unreasonable. As you know, the appeal is extensive. There's a lot of preparation to do. As you know, we've been fully busy with case 2-2. We've been flooded with case 3 and 4 documents, so we have been working, as argued last week or 2 weeks ago, almost non-stop. I would argue that the requested time is not unreasonable.
Je pense que ce n'est pas
but we haven't come up with a final position yet because, as I said, we understood your request to be that as soon as there's a scheduling order, we would then
come up with our views.
President, thank you, and thank you to all parties for your observations and comments on the various issues that the Chamber has considered the challenges we are facing, and now the International Co-Prosecutor.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. I was just waiting for to make some very brief comments on the submissions of the Kyusampan team. First, we would agree with the Nguyen Chia team that it's premature at the moment to even talk about the time necessary to prepare appeal because we don't have neither a date from the Supreme Court nor an indication of the format, how many days hearings that will be, and whether the Supreme Court is going to limit the parties to specific issues to talk about, which I would hope that they would because there's somewhere between 300 and 400 grounds of appeal. So we think it's premature to talk about time for preparation. As far as the time allotted to the expert on the CHAM, we do think 2 days is more than sufficient, that that's sufficient time. But I do concur with counsel's proposal that the chamber, it would be more efficient to have the expert testify at the end of the segment after the other witnesses. I think that makes sense.
Après que l'on ait entendu toutes les témoins, c'est plus logique.
Thank you. The chamber will take this issue into deliberation.
La chambre tiendra compte de toutes ces observations dans le cadre de ces délibérations.
Sort out this issue. Any issues that we can resolve it immediately, we will do it. And others, we will
tout ce que nous pouvons régler tout de suite, nous le ferons. Et les questions en suspens seront traitées en temps utile.
Hearing today is coming to a conclusion,
voilà
and the chamber will adjourn now and resume on the 5th of October.
Le 5 octobre.
On Monday next week, and chambers of here 2 TC W 950 and there are 2 TC W 904 as a reserve
sera le témoin de réserve.
Witness. After 2 TCW 950. So this is the notice to all the chambers, all the parties and members of the public.
Mr. Bishop, no hearing tomorrow.
The President, no, there is no hearing toward the end of this week.
Il n'y a plus d'audience après aujourd'hui.
Because we do not have any individuals whom we can hear, because those individuals are not available for the hearing. The security guards are now instructed to bring the two co-accused back to the detention facility and have them back in this courtroom on the 5th of October, that is Monday, before 9 a.m. The court is now adjourned.